Adrian, give me the signal when you're ready. Yeah, I always think of that song. I mean, that psalm. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." And whenever I start to worship, I think about that. I think, let's go with joy. Be happy to be here. Why don't you stand up and join me in this first song? We stand and lift up our hands. For the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. Filled with His glory, holy is the Lord God. up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord. Together we sing, everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. You can sit if you want. When the song says stand, I think we should stand. Lift up your hands too. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk. For me, and only
Oh, we're going to have communion. You can be seated for now. We have communion second Sunday of every month. Is that it? So we don't mix it with the third Sunday every month, which is the potluck Sunday, right? And so that's good. In the book of 1 Corinthians, in chapter 11, Paul talks to the Corinthian church. He said, you're coming together, but it's not really for the Lord's Supper. He says, you're coming together, and you're coming together for basically a potluck and calling it the Lord's Supper. And he said, there's divisions among you. There's cliques. There's people getting in line and others going hungry, and you're getting drunk. He said, this isn't good. And now the Corinthian church, the Corinthians were a party people, you know. And so I think part of that was coming, their culture was coming into the church. And it's not necessarily a bad thing for culture to influence the church, but when it detracts from the solemnity of such a thing as the Lord's Supper, then Paul had to correct them. And so he said, you know, I delivered to you that which I've received from the Lord. And he's saying, this is the thing. When he said, on the same night that Jesus was betrayed, he said he took the cup, or he took the bread first, and he said, this is my body which is broken for you. And he says, take this and eat it, and when you do this in remembrance of me. And so we're taken not into a love feast. We're taken into God's love. We're taken into the love that he showed to us by going to the cross. And we're taken, really, we're doing a memorial service again for Jesus Christ, what he did when he died for us. We know he's risen again. We know he's seated at the right hand of the Father. We know these things. But he said, when you do this, take the bread representing my body. He said, do this in remembrance of me. And so as we take the bread this morning, we're remembering that his body was broken by the Roman whip and being nailed on the cross. And we have to remember that our freedom, our salvation is free to us, but it came at a great cost. God paid for it. That's the only reason it's free. He gave everything for us. So let's take the bread. And Paul said, in the same manner, after dinner, he took the cup and he said, this is my blood in the new covenant, which is shed for you. And he said, take this and drink it and do this in remembrance of me. So we remember that in the Old Testament, the sacrifices were put together, and over and over, God told them to take the blood and to drain it, not to eat it, because the blood, life of the flesh is in the blood. And so as Jesus Christ's blood ran out on the cross, his life was poured out for us, and we take the blood of the covenant as the blood of the perfect sacrifice, not the imperfect sacrifices of the blood of bulls and goats, which could never take away sin. But the blood of Jesus Christ has taken away sin for those of us who receive it. And so as we take the cup, we remember Jesus gave it all. He gave his life for you and me. And so we do this in remembrance of him. Let's take the cup. And Paul said, in doing so, you demonstrate that the Lord's death until he returns. So until he returns, we're going to continue this memorial. God bless you.
Streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood. my heart has peace with God, forgiveness. For all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross,
love to do some hymns, and this is one of my favorites. I hope it's one of you guys's too.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder I hear the rolling thunder, thy power.
ask that you would also continue to pray for our country, especially as we go into elections. So we are in Genesis chapter 36. And we're going to talk about the descendants of Esau. I am going to pray, and then we'll go ahead and go into the Word of God. Father, I just pray right now, Lord, that I would decrease and that you would increase. I pray that every word that proceeds from my mouth would be from your heart, Jesus. Speak to us from your heart. Reveal truth, revelation, simplicity in its greatest form, that we might be able to grasp truth and apply it in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I got to Genesis 36, and I said, oh my God, here we go, Esau's genealogy. And so-and-so begot so-and-so, and so-and-so begot so-and-so. And I said, oh, Lord, here I go. I almost, midway through the week, was going to go to chapter 37 to bypass the genealogy of Esau. And the Holy Spirit said, no, go back. So I left the story of Joseph and came back to the genealogy of Esau. I'm going to go through chapter 36 because that's how Calvary Chapel teaches verse by verse. So if you turn to Genesis chapter 36, we're going to begin with verse 1. Now this is the genealogy, and I'm going to be reading through verse 5. This is the genealogy of Esau, who is Edom. Esau took his wives from the daughters of Canaan, Ada, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, Ahoibama, the daughter of Ana, the daughter of Zibion, the Hivite, and Basemath, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nabajoth. Now Ada bore Eliphaz to Esau, and Basemath bore Raul, and Aholibama bore Jeush, and Jalam, and Korah. These were the sons of Esau who were born to him in the land of Canaan. Now, Edom means red, and it's Esau's nickname. I guess he had a reddish complexion, and so he got the nickname of red. And Esau's wives gave birth to five sons. He had three wives, Ada, Basemath, and Aholibama, and he had five sons. And then we're also going to see about his grandsons. But here I want to talk about monogamy. Polygamy is not supported in Scripture. In fact, Jesus himself talks to us about monogamy. Monogamy is marriage between one man and one woman. It was God's intention that is how it was to be from the beginning. And Jesus talks about this. This is in Matthew 19, verses 3-6. Verse 3 reads, the Pharisees also came to him, testing him, and saying to him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for just any reason? And he answered to them, have you not read that he who made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. Clearly, Jesus is telling us that the Father's intention from the very beginning was for monogamy. That is, one husband and one wife. Now, the fact that the forefathers in Scripture did that, well, they're sinning. They're going against God's will. They're not doing what God requires of them. So just because we see that application in the Bible doesn't mean that God condones it, nor does the church. So the church does not condone polygamy, and God never intended it for it to exist. We can see, looking back at Jacob's family, and we're going to go into the next chapter, chapter 37, Joseph, who was a favored son, and having a favored wife and having multiple wives, there was a lot of strife in that family because of that situation. So, you know, God tells us what to do and what not to do for our own good, not to keep us from what, you know, that we desire, but to keep us from suffering the consequences of sin. So let's go on, verses 6 through 8. Esau moves away from Jacob. Verse 6, then Esau took his wives, his sons, his daughters, and all the persons of his household, his cattle and all his animals and all his goods, which he had gained in the land of Canaan. And he went to a country away from the presence of his brother Jacob, for their possessions were too great for them to dwell together, and the land where they were strangers could not support them because of their livestock. So Esau dwelt in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. The land where they were strangers cannot support both Jacob and Esau. Esau sees that, you know, they have a certain amount of animals, and the land can't support both nations or both tribes, if you will. So Esau decides to move down. And where he moved is south of the Dead Sea. It's Edom. That's where he moved to. And there, now we're going to get into his genealogy. We're going to find some interesting things in this chapter. One concerning Job, which I never realized, but we'll talk about that when we get there. Verses 19 to 14, the descendants of Esau. Verse 9 reads, and this is the genealogy of Esau, the father of the Edomites in Mount Seir. These were the names of Esau's sons, Eliphaz, the sons of Ada, and wife of Esau, and Reuel, the son of Basemath, the wife of Esau. And the sons of Eliphaz were Teman, Omar, Sepho, Catmon, and Kenaz. Those are Esau's grandchildren. Now, Timnah was the concubine of Eliphaz, Esau's son, and she bore Amalek to Eliphaz. These were the sons of Ada, Esau's wife. These were the sons of Reuel, Nahath, Zerah, Shammah, Mizah. These were the sons of Basemath, Esau's wife. These were the sons of Ahobamah, Esau's wife, the daughter of Anah, the daughter of Zibeon. And she bore to Esau Jeush, Jalam, and Korah. Esau's descendants. Esau had three wives, Ada, Basemath, and Oholibamah. Esau had five sons. From Ada, he had Eliphaz. From Basemath, Reuel. From Oholibamah, she had Jeush, Jalam, and Korah. Now, he had five sons, and he had 10 grandchildren. Teman, from Eliphaz, Teman, Omar, Sepho, Gatam, Kenaz, and by Tima, Amalek. From Basemath, Reuel, he had four grandchildren, Nahath, Zerah, Shema, Mizah. From Oholibamah, she had Jeush, Jalam, and Korah. So basically, Esau had five sons and 10 grandchildren. Now, as I'm reflecting on this, why did the Holy Spirit record Esau's genealogy? Because God made promises to both sons of Jacob that they would both be two great nations, and so they wanted to distinguish between the two nations. Jacob, his nation, would bring about the Messiah. And we're going to see that Esau's nations will give Israel problems. And in fact, the last one were the Amalekites. When Moses went in with the people out of Egypt, and they were going through the land, remember when the rod was lifted up and they helped Moses keep it lifted up? Those were the Amalekites that they were fighting. They were basically fighting. They would not allow them to go through the territory. And so they were fighting, really, relatives. Very, very sad situation, but this is the truth. Verses 15 through 19, the chiefs of Edom. These were the chiefs of the sons of Esau. Now, chiefs are chieftains or tribal leaders that developed in Esau's descendants. The sons of Eliphaz, the firstborn son of Esau, were Chief Teman, Chief Omar, Chief Sepho, Chief Kenneth, Chief Korah, Chief Gatim, Chief Amalek. These were the chiefs of Eliphaz in the land of Edom. They were the sons of Ada. These were the sons of Reuel, Esau's son, Chief Nahath, Chief Zerah, Chief Shammah, Chief Mizah. These were the chiefs of Reuel in the land of Edom. These were the sons of Basemath, Esau's wife. And there were sons of Alabama, Esau's wife, Chief Jewish, Chief Jalem, Chief Korah. These were the chiefs who descended from Aholabama, Esau's wife, the daughter of Anah. These were the sons of Esau, who is Edom, and these were their chiefs. Now, it's interesting that what we just read in verses 9 through 14 is the same genealogy we read in verses 9 through 14. So what we just read is still the sons and the grandsons of Esau, who also became tribal leaders. Verses 20 through 30, the sons of Seir. These were the sons of Seir, the Horite, who inhabited the land, Lotan, Shabel, Zibeon, Anah, Dishon, Ezer, Dishon. These were the chiefs of the Horites, the sons of Seir in the land of Edom. The sons of Seir. Seir is the patriarch of the Horite clan, which eventually became one people with Esau's descendants. So the sons of Seir were the inhabitants of the land who were already there before Esau went into that land, but they intermarried, married with each other and became one. But this is all written by Moses, and Moses is giving us, as it was passed down by Jacob, that Moses is giving us the history of what happened during that time. So Seir is a Horite. He is from another nation. He is not from Esau, but they intermix. That's why they're brought in. Verses 22 through 30 records the sons of Seir, sons, his grandchildren. So we're going to read verses 22 through 30. And the sons of Lotan were Hori and Hamam. Lotan's sister was Timnah. Timnah is mentioned because she was a concubine of Esau's older son, Eliphaz. These were the sons of Shobal, Elvan, Manahath, Ebal, Shepho, and Onam. These were the sons of Zibeon, both Aja and Anah. This was Anah who found the water in the wilderness as he pastured the donkeys of his father Zibeon. These were the children of Anah, Dishon, and Olibama, the daughter of Anah. These were the sons of Dishon, Hemdan, Ishban, Ithron, and Sharon. These were the sons of Ezer, Bilhan, Savan, and Achan. These were the sons of Dishon, Uz, and Aaron. These were the chiefs of the Horites, Chief Lotan, Chief Shobal, Chief Zibeon, Chief Anah, Chief Dishon, Chief Ezer, Chief Dishon, and these were the chiefs of the Horites according to their chiefs in the land of Seir. The chiefs mentioned in verses 29 through 30 had 19 sons of their own. Verses 31 through 39, the kings of Edom. Now, these were the kings who reigned in the land of Edom before any king reigned over the children of Israel. So before there was any kings over the land of Israel, the nation of Israel, they're going to now list the kings that existed prior to Israel becoming a nation and having a king of their own. Bela, the son of Beor, reigned in Edom, and the name of his city was Dinabah. And when Bela died, Jobab, the son of Zerah of Bozrah, reigned in his place. Now, this is interesting because many scholars, theologians, and I'm going to quote from Chuck Smith, This Jobab is a grandson of Esau. And Jobab is known to be Job in the Bible. So this really got my attention because Esau was hated and Jacob was loved. But out of the hated one, now God didn't, God's not saying I hate your guts. God's saying I hate the actions that you're doing that are going against me, because Esau intermarried with nations that were worshiping false gods. And today we have false gods. We can worship money. We can worship people. We can worship family members. We can worship possessions. And if they become more important to us than God, then yes, we have idols in our own lives. So this is why God says that he hated Esau. He hated his actions. He didn't hate him. God loves everyone. He desires no man to be lost or lose salvation. Salvation is open to anyone who will accept it. Salvation from Jesus is open to anyone who will accept it. But what I find fascinating, and this is a reading from Chuck Smith's writings, what I find fascinating is out of one who did so much wrong, we see one who did so much right. Job was a righteous man, and he pleased the Lord. And to prove how righteous he was, he allowed Satan to go and do what he did to him, and it's tragic and sad, but God is God. He will do what he must do. But here's what Chuck Smith writes. We know that Job was a ruler, a king over an area. It could be that this Jobab here is actually the Job of the book. And of course, Eliphaz, then being one of his uncles who came to visit him at the time that he was going through such great personal loss and problems, he went there to encourage him. Eliphaz, being Job's uncle, went there to actually encourage him as he was going through all these things. So Chuck Smith is tying in that the Job and the Eliphaz, which are Esau's descendants, that this is a story being played out. But what's encouraging to me, and we must all, think about this, is our destiny and our purpose in life does not matter which family we come to, who our mother and father was, who our relatives were. It doesn't matter. Why? Job came from a grandfather whose actions were hated by God. But God honored Job. He said he was a righteous man. In fact, he said to Satan, "Have you seen my servant Job? There is none like him on the earth." And it's very encouraging to me because many of us come from families that maybe we're not walking with the Lord. Maybe we're doing things that would then not glorify God. But God honors the individual, his actions, his decisions, his thoughts, how much love he has for his son. So we all have hope, irregardless of where we come from, who our parents were, or our grandparents, because here Job was a grandchild. Even going back to a grandparent, it doesn't matter. God looks at you, your heart, and will judge you based on you, not what your fathers did or your grandparents did, right? We're born again. Though we came from our parents and from our grandparents, we're born again spiritually. We have a new DNA, a new lineage. It's through Jesus Christ now. We are changed. We are made a new creation. When we accept Jesus into our heart, we're no longer the same. And within us is placed a Spirit of God, which does a work as you hear the Word of God. The Word of God is living, and as you hear the Word of God, it is living. It is doing a work through the Holy Spirit that's in you. It will change you. There's one thing that I know to be true, and many of you also probably know to be true. Because Jesus' Spirit lives within me, if I do anything contrary to his will or I sin against him, the Holy Spirit will not let me live it down until I acknowledge it and repent and move on. And this is the work of the Holy Spirit, to bring to our attention the things that do not glorify his Father, glorify his Son. So though we all may come from a lineage or a line of in the family that didn't acknowledge God, it doesn't matter. God doesn't look at that. He looks at every individual and the decisions that we make as individuals. Do we receive Jesus as our Savior? And do we follow him? You know what a disciple is? A disciple. A disciple is one who is taught, who is taught by Jesus. A disciple is one who is a student of a master. That's what a disciple is scripturally, a student of a master. And if you love Jesus, you sit at his feet and you learn from him and you listen to him. The spirit that is within us will communicate to us that which is wrong and that which is right, and it will change us and form us into the image of Jesus Christ. So that to me, I'm glad the Holy Spirit stopped me and said, go back to chapter 36, because there's something there for everyone. And that is that we have a hope in Christ. It doesn't matter what our family did, what our parents did, or what our grandparents did. And sometimes you, by you accepting Jesus and your family seeing the transformation within you, then that influence affects your family. The effect of what Christ has on a person's heart, their attitudes, their behavior, their words, their mannerism, the change that happens will have an influence not only in your family, but all those in your circle of influence, all those who maybe at work you're working with. They will see changes. They will see a transformation. And that's light. That's salt, because they see something different. See someone different. You're not the same. You've changed. What happened to you? How many of you have heard that? What's happened to you? You're not the same. You're not the same. What's happened? Jesus lives in me. That's what's happened. He lives in me, and I'm allowing him to live through me. That is where true joy comes from. Joy that is not impacted by our outward circumstances, you know, a tragedy, even with what happened yesterday with our previous president, even that tragic thing, we know God is in control, God is in charge, even though it's sad and what happened to the family, we know that there is one who holds everything in his hands, and the outcome will be according to his will. The end of the story is glorious. We know the end of the story. How many of us pick up a book and go right to the end of the story because we want to see what is this book all about? We can go to the end of the story and see that we will live in heaven in a beautiful place. I was talking to a brother earlier about mansions, 2-point-something million somewhere in Seattle. And he says, brother, you and I can't afford that. I said, no, but I got a greater mansion waiting for me in heaven. And the cost has already been paid. Jesus paid the cost of that mansion that we're going to be going to. A heavenly place where we're all going to live. That's the end of the story. Let's go on. So it's very likely that chapter 36, we have the names of those involved in the timing, at least, of the book. And this is Chuck Smith speaking here. This is not scripture. Chuck Smith says, so it's very likely that chapter 36, we have the names of those involved in the timing, at least of the book of Job and the life of Job. He lived about this time, which helps you get things now sort of in perspective. It means that Job was living at the same time as Jacob and Esau and these events. When Jobab died, Hushman of the land of the Temanites reigned in his place. And when Hushman died, Hadad, the son of Bedad, who attacked Midian in the field of Moab, reigned in his place. And the name of that city was Avith. I'm sorry, it is scripture. Verse 36, when Hadad died, Samla of Misraka reigned in his place. Verse 37, And when Samlah died, Saul of Rehoboth by the river reigned in his place. Verse 38. When Saul died, Baal-Hanan, the son of Achor, reigned in his place. And when Baal-Hanan, the son of Achor, died, Hadar reigned in his place. And the name of his city was Pa. His wife's name was Mahatabel, and the daughter of Matred, the daughter of Mezabab. This section of the chapter covers the kings who lived during the time of Moses. So it's believed Moses added this to the chapter. Eight kings are listed, and three of those kings have cities. That's verses 31 through 39. Now we're coming towards the end, and this is the chiefs of Esau, verses 40 through 43. And these were the names of the chiefs of Esau according to their families and their places by their names: chief Timnah, chief Alva, chief Jaheth, chief Alabama, chief Ela, chief Pinan, chief Kenaz, chief Taman, chief Mibzar, chief Magdiel, and chief Iram. These were the chiefs of Edom according to their dwelling places in the land of their possession. Esau was the father of the Edomites. This last section of this chapter lists 11 important chiefs descended from Esau, believed to be the most important of all the chiefs. So, I want to kind of summarize and reflect on what the Holy Spirit is really communicating to us here. And what stands out the most to me is that God will hold each and every one of us accountable and responsible for our own decisions. Okay, we can't look at mom and dad and say it's their fault. No, God says, you have the opportunity to choose Jesus, choose life, have a new spirit, be a new creation. You can't blame mom and dad. Mom and dad will be judged, and grandfather and grandmother and so on and so forth. They'll be judged for their decisions. And the greatest decision that we can all make is to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, because it erases all of the bad decisions. You're forgiven. You're forgiven. It erases all of our sins, all our bad decisions we made, because we accept Jesus into our heart. And he forgives us. He doesn't hold anything against us. And you know what's beautiful about that? It is so nice to be forgiven. But what's beautiful about that is he gives us, because we are forgiven, he gives us the ability to forgive others their trespasses. Forgive those who trespass against you. So it's a beautiful thing, forgiveness. Because it frees us from the sin that holds us back, that binds us. But more importantly, allows us to forgive. Because in forgiving, we too, just as you receive freedom from sin, we too receive freedom from letting bitterness take root in our heart. We're free. We're free in forgiveness. We're free. As we forgive others, we receive more freedom in our heart. The less I judge, the better off I am. I'm learning that. The less I judge people, the happier I am. I might be a fruit inspector to pray for people, but I'm not the judge. I don't, we're not judges. There's only one judge who will judge us at the end of time. That's Jesus Christ. So we ought not to be judging each other critically, but loving one another and praying for anyone who ever falls short, who is bearing fruit that is not of Christ. We're to pray. We're not to judge. Before, at one time, there I walked. Who am I to judge? I was lost in sin, and his forgiveness freed me, and our forgiveness frees others. And more importantly, it frees us. And with that, I'm going to close, ask Don to come forward. I do want to bring a reminder to you. As you go out today, there is a list out there for potluck. If you write down, if you're going to attend potluck, write down your name and what you're bringing. This helps people. It helps people to see what's being brought, and so you don't, you know, we don't have 10 pies and one pot of beans, so or 10 pots of beans and one pie. So it kind of balances things out. Go ahead and write down what it is you're going to bring, and it gives people an idea of, you know, what the need is. Okay, what else can I bring other than what's already on there? So as you go out, and our potlucks really, and a sister told me they're not potlucks because we don't believe in luck. They're blessed, changed by His Spirit and be changed by His Word. But fellowship is important. Fellowship is important. It's encouraged in the Bible that we fellowship together. If you can come, that would be great. I'm going to close in prayer and then ask Dawn to do a song, and she can close this again at the end of the song. Father, I thank you and I praise you for your word, and I thank you that your Spirit had me press through this chapter. I pray, Lord, that we would glean from it and realize that our history as far as parents or grandparents is irrelevant to you. It's our decision. It's our heart that you look at, and our decisions that base how you look at us, our decision to choose Christ. If there be anyone here today, Father, I pray that they would have the boldness to come forth and talk to the pastor, talk to an elder, talk to a brother, and say, I want to receive Christ today. I want to be free. I want that freedom that's talked about and displayed and shown by your Spirit. I pray that they would have the courage to just accept your Son as their Lord and Savior, and that they would receive a new nature, and that they would receive your Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray.
Why don't you stand and join me? The first time we sang this song, the ladies actually cried because it makes a perspective that you don't normally think. But I lost a dear friend this year, and she's now in front of God in heaven. And I think of her when I sing this song. So please join me.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine, surrounded by your you. will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, only imagine, only imagine.
Lord, as we go out into the world today, Lord, I pray, Lord, that our hearts would be here, right here, worshiping you. And Lord, that we would be that example in the world, Lord, to bring people to you so they can also experience your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Sorry, I started worshiping, and when I worship, I can't.